Good afternoon. The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio this afternoon is Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy. I would say to those members who would wish to seek to ask a supplementary question to please press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function if online. Question number one, I call Keith Brown.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact that any future devolution of employment law to the Scottish Parliament would have on the development of the wellbeing economy.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
Securing the full range of powers in relation to employment will enable the Scottish Parliament to implement policies that will best meet Scotland's distinct needs. These powers would create fairer workplaces, enhance workers' rights in Scotland and help shift the curve on poverty and deliver upon our shared ambition for a just transition to a net zero, nature positive, wellbeing economy that's fair, that's greener and it's a growing economy as well. And in building a new Scotland, a stronger economy with independence, we proposed a number of specific labour market measures, including a fair national minimum wage set at a rate that better reflects the cost of living and applies to all ages and better access to flexible working as well.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank the Minister for that response and ask whether he has any idea at all why, given the fact that both the Scottish and UK trade union congresses have come out in support of the devolution of employment law, and a number of Labour MSPs in this Parliament have spoken previously in the Chamber in support of that. Has he any explanations to why not a single Labour MP signed the motion considered by the Parliament last night in support of the devolution of employment law? And a motion which didn't mention independence, only mentioned devolution, which was meant to have been the settled policy of the Labour Party. And is he aware whether the UK Labour Party still supports this policy of devolving employment law to the Scottish Parliament?
I would suggest to the Minister that he answers the points with reference to matters that fall within his jurisdiction. Minister.
Well, the Scottish Government supports the devolution of employment law, and we'd ask all parties in this chamber, particularly the Labour Party, given their past comments on this, to support the Scottish Government's position. But it does seem that, given the issue highlighted by Keith Brown, that their enthusiasm for the devolution of employment law appears to be waning. And that is particularly worrying for Scotland, as it seems to be waning because a Westminster election is approaching. And that should worry us all in Scotland. And I urge the Labour Party to clarify their position and to get full-heartedly behind the Scottish Government's position that the devolution of employment law should happen as soon as possible in the event there's a Labour government in Westminster.
I call question number two, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what it's doing to tackle gender pay gap and promote equal pay.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
Our 2023 programme for government outlines the direct action the Scottish Government is taking to tackle gender pay gaps and promote equal pay in Scotland's labour market. This includes action in sectors with historically low pay and job insecurity, where women are disproportionately overrepresented. From April 2024, adult social care workers delivering direct care in commissioned services will see their pay increase to a minimum of £12 per hour, to give an example. And alongside that, we will provide funding to uplift pay in the private, voluntary, independent sector to £12 an hour for those delivering early learning and childcare.
Marie McNair.
I welcome the Scottish Government's efforts to close the gender pay gap with a real determination to make progress. It is clear that the UK Government are holding progress back and Labour's appalling record on equal pay is a concern. Does the Minister agree with me that if we are to aspire to end the gender pay gap using all tools available, it is essential employment laws devolve to this Parliament?
Minister.
Well, I think that the Member gives yet another reason as to why employment law should be devolved to this Parliament, and not only that, but as soon as possible. And of course, given that the median gender pay gap for all employees is below the UK gap, 12.2% versus 14.9%, and has been since many, many years, and that the median gender pay gap for full-time employees in Scotland is lower than the UK as a whole, I think it shows that where we have influence as a Parliament, we're making a real difference to those affected by this issue in Scotland. Therefore, the more powers we have, the more positive difference we can make.
I call question number three, Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to help businesses take full advantage of Scotland's hydrogen potential.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A Hydrogen Action Plan published in 2022 is supported by a programme of capital funding designed to accelerate the production of renewable hydrogen in Scotland. Funding to date includes over £7 million in grants offered to projects via the Hydrogen Innovation Scheme, and these are projects which will drive innovation in renewable hydrogen production, storage and distribution. And the next tranche of the Hydrogen Investment Programme, the Green Hydrogen Fund, will launch later this year. This fund will be open to projects that support renewable hydrogen production from Scotland's abundant renewable energy resources.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for her answer, and I look forward to those announcements in the future. But I would like to ask the Minister, Presiding Officer, how can we build on the successful work on transport, hydrogen-powered transport in Aberdeen? What can we do to increase the amount of hydrogen refuelling sites throughout Scotland?
Minister.
Thank Kevin Stewart for that question. I visited the Hydrogen Hub quite early on in my tenure as Minister. Very impressive. We've invested over £15 million from our Energy Transition Fund towards the development of the Aberdeen Hydrogen Hub. The hub aims to accelerate that hydrogen economy in Aberdeen. And in fact, they're leading the way in that. And I know that from my visit there that they're having visits from other local authorities to look at that model and to establish it throughout local authorities in the whole of the UK. We will continue to work with partners in the public and private sector to understand and stimulate the demand for and the infrastructure needed for hydrogen vehicles. The Zero Emission Truck Task Force, which includes Transport Scotland, is exploring the energy infrastructure required for HGVs, including consideration of hydrogen refuelling, and we will publish an HGV decarbonisation pathway next year.
I have obtained requests for a number of supplementaries. I intend to take each of them, so hopefully everybody can be reasonably brief. I call supplementary Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think we all agree that Scotland is uniquely placed to really capitalise on the green hydrogen market. I know the Minister was at an event last night with the supply chain. I was at a business meeting yesterday morning when they said that it's really, really important and going forward it should be demand-led. So what's the Scottish Government doing to create a marketplace for those green hydrogen companies that are really coming to fruition now?
Minister.
Well, there's two markets, I guess, available for hydrogen. There's a domestic market and then there's an export market. In the domestic market, actually, the UK government, I was very pleased, I had a meeting this morning with Graeme Stewart, where in answer to my question around injecting 20% of hydrogen into the gas grid, they said that they were actively looking at that. It's something that we've been calling on for quite a while. That's a use for hydrogen. Also, distilleries are using hydrogen to decarbonise as well, which is going to make a massive sector, obviously. But I also got the opportunity to say that Neil Gray is in Germany at the moment to promote and further Scotland's hydrogen interests and support Scottish companies to participate and benefit from the development of the international hydrogen market, as Mr. Whittle will know. In particular, Germany have got already working to decarbonise their industry using hydrogen, so that's a great market for us.
Supplementary, Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I welcome the Minister's reference to renewable hydrogen, as it's critical that we produce green hydrogen in Scotland? And would she acknowledge the importance of linking to renewable electricity production and create jobs and opportunities, not just in the North East, as she's outlined, but also in Grangemouth?
Minister.
Yeah, absolutely. We have got a commitment to that. There is already quite a lot of hydrogen innovation happening throughout the country. If you look at, if Ms. Boyack will be aware of the EMEC project in Orkney, for example, they had a situation where they couldn't get their tidal energy into the grid, so they made hydrogen with it. And there's quite a lot of, sort of micro hydrogen production happening throughout Scotland as well. But certainly I also have been having conversations in Grangemouth about the hydrogen that they're going to be produced. Very positive, more recent noises about green hydrogen in particular.
Supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Shetland's well placed as an energy hub at the centre of the energy-rich North Sea. The local Orion project aims to produce wind-powered green hydrogen by 2025. What engagement has the Scottish Government had with the Orion project?
Minister.
Well, I haven't had the pleasure of going up to Shetland yet, mainly because my Cabinet Secretary went up to the Northern Isles in the summer, so it didn't make sense for us both to go, but I actually look forward to engaging. Perhaps Ms. Wishart would like to invite me.
And supplementary, Claire Baker.
Thank you very much. In my region, the empty Longannet site in Kincardine has huge potential for green jobs. So can I ask the Minister what recent discussions she's had with Scottish Power, who are the owners of the site, about what their plans are for the site and to help advance the government's hydrogen ambition?
Minister.
Well, I'll have to look back on all the engagements I've had with the owners of that site just to see and get back to Claire Baker on that. It is entirely possible that Mr Gray has also had engagement with him as well. I'll get back to Ms Baker and let her know what that's been.
Question number four, Murdo Fraser.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on when the next set of export statistics will be published.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
Export Statistics Scotland provides the official estimates of the value of Scotland's exports, and it covers Scotland's exports of goods and services internationally and to the rest of the UK, excluding oil and gas. The next set of statistics will be published on the 29th of November 2023, and that will include data up to 2021. This was pre-announced by the Chief Statistician in August of this year. HMRC Regional Trade and Goods Statistics, which include figures for Scotland, are also released quarterly, with the next update for the third quarter of 2023 due to be released on the 14th of December. And the Scottish Government also published quarterly manufacturing exports for Scotland, statistics for Scotland, with the most recent data covering the period up to the quarter 2023.
Martin Fraser.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? The last set of export statistics were published in December 2021, so it's been a long gap since we've seen the last set. But what the last set showed was that Scottish exports to the EU accounted for 19% of the total, but we exported three times more, 60% of the total, to the rest of the UK. Doesn't this just demonstrate the folly of us seeking to try and align ourselves with the EU at the expense of the rest of the UK, which is by far the largest market for Scottish exporters?
Minister.
What the Scottish Government should be doing for the sake of jobs in Scotland and the Scottish economy is increasing our exports to the rest of the UK and to the rest of the world, and also to the European Union. And exports to the European Union, of course, have suffered as a result of the Brexit imposed on Scotland by the rest of the UK, which we did not vote for, and that has led to decline in many key exports to the European Union. And, of course, if Scotland were to be a member of the European Union in their own right, that would open up lots of export opportunities for Scotland. But our exports are performing extremely well just now, Presiding Officer, and we should congratulate our businesses for doing that and be proud of that.
Again, I have received a number of requests for supplementaries. I intend to take each of them. I call Colin Beattie.
Can the Minister provide an update on the continued impact that export barriers caused by Brexit are having on business costs?
Minister.
The latest Business Insights and Conditions survey, which was published in September, show that of the businesses in Scotland that face challenges with exporting, over a third, 36.1% to be precise, named Brexit as the main cause. It also finds that over a quarter of Scottish businesses are facing extra costs as a result of Brexit, with 16.2% seeing higher transportation costs, 12.5% facing increased red tape. Furthermore, the latest small business survey, conducted between November 2022 and April 2023, reported that half of Scotland's small and medium-sized employers who predicted a decrease in turnover next year highlighted Brexit as a contributing factor. So these additional barriers and costs continue to weigh on the economy as a whole, and the Office for Budget Responsibility estimate that UK GDP will be 4% lower in the long run due to Brexit. And in Scotland, we've experienced a 38% decline in exports of fruit and veg, for instance, and a 45% fall in exports.
Thank you, Minister. We need to
of
jump
animal
to the
feed.
Next supplementary. I call Willie Rennie.
One side talks down the trade with the United Kingdom, and the other side talks down trade with Europe. Instead of seeking and revelling in the prospect of new trade barriers, why don't both governments just work together to break down those trade barriers?
Minister.
Scotland, of course, will continue to try and do our best to break down trade barriers, and that's why we oppose Brexit, and I believe the Members' Party also oppose Brexit, albeit appears to have unfortunately changed its mind because of the views in the rest of the UK, irrespective of the damage in Scotland. As I said before, our strategy, and we do a lot of work in London, for instance, promoting Scottish exports, is to increase exports to the rest of the UK, the rest of the world, and the European Union as well, and that's the best outcome for Scotland's economy.
And I call supplementary Ivan McKee.
The Minister will be aware that in the period since Brexit, Scottish exports, excluding oil and gas, have been growing around twice the rate of those from the rest of the UK, but UK export growth as a whole has been lagging behind international competitors. Does the Minister agree with me that this demonstrates both the folly of Brexit, but also confirms the approach of the Scottish Government with a coherent strategy to boost exports, agreed with industry and which is delivering results?
Minister.
I absolutely agree with Ivan McKee, and I thank him for his efforts to help build up the fantastic track record in exports that Scotland has in its previous role. And the value of Scotland's international goods exported increased by 13.2% in the year ending in June 2023 compared to the previous year, which is greater in percentage terms than the 12% increase experienced by the UK. So Parliament should celebrate and be proud of the fact that Scotland is outperforming the rest of the UK in terms of exports and indeed inward investment as well. And that is really good news for the Scottish Government's approach, working in partnership with our business community and our agencies, and good news for jobs in Scotland.
I call question number 5, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what impact the measures in the Programme for Government 2023-24 will have on the growth of the economy in North Ayrshire.
Minister Richard Lougheed.
Our programme for government will increase equality, create a fairer society and drive opportunity for the people and businesses of North Ayrshire. It will promote inclusion and reduce inequality in the area, benefiting in part from our £70 million investment in community regeneration. And it will support the delivery of the Ayrshire Growth Deal, of course, which we are investing £103 million in to transform North Ayrshire and the wider regional economy.
Ruth Maguire.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Can the Minister outline, a quality job that pays well is one of the primary routes out of poverty. Can the Minister outline what action the Scottish Government and partners are taking to ensure that all sizes of companies in my constituency are able to contribute to tackling inequality whilst growing their businesses?
Minister.
Well, as the member will be aware, the Government's policy is that business is absolutely vital to creating a wellbeing economy, and it's got a key role to play in Cunningham South and beyond. And it's why we support businesses to be a force for good, to put purpose and fair work at their very heart, and noting that this also benefits productivity and profits as well as people. And as part of our £11.5 million investment in the Ayrshire Growth Deal Communities Wealth Building and the Regional Skills and Inclusion Programmes, we will be supporting local businesses to put fair work first, while also supporting local people to ensure they've got the skills that businesses require. And we're also working with other organisations like Developing the Young Workforce in Ayrshire. So the issue raised by the member is central to our economic strategy for the whole of Scotland, including in Ayrshire.
Question number 6, Maggie Chapman.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its work to ensure that seasonal agricultural workers have access to effective worker voice under its Fair Work commitments.
Minister Richard Lougheed.
The Scottish Government is committed to ensuring agricultural workers have access to having effective voices under its Fair Work commitments. And in March 2023, we provided funding of £123,000 to support the reopening of the Worker Support Centre. And the WSC assists all seasonal agricultural and horticultural workers in Scotland, irrespective of nationality, to access free, impartial and confidential information on workplace rights.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Migrant workers, particularly those on the seasonal worker visa in horticulture, including in the North East region, are known to be at risk of exploitation and trafficking. They are not unionised. They face significant language barriers, are often housed in poor, unregulated housing, and struggle to access healthcare. And they are at the mercy of their employers, who may, without notice, say there is no work for them, leaving them stranded without money or options. What further actions will the Scottish Government take to reduce the risks of trafficking and exploitation and ensure all workers have access to individual and collective workplace representation?
Minister.
Well, as I said in response to the very important issue raised by the member, the Scottish Government has funded the Worker Support Centre to assist all migrant seasonal agricultural workers in Scotland. We have produced seasonal workers' rights information leaflets, which include guidance on human trafficking and exploitation. And we have outreach arrangements in place to support workers who speak Ukrainian, Romanian, Russian, Polish and English. And they're available at a range of times to talk to workers and to provide information or support in terms of the outreach workers and the work they're doing. and where appropriate, the centre can refer workers to legal charities, the Scottish Government's agricultural wages enforcement teams and other advisers for further support with a range of issues they may face. Member may also be aware there was independent research published recently that gave recommendations to be pursued by the Scottish Government and indeed the UK Government in this regard as well. So there is a lot of work underway to ensure that we treat this issue seriously.
I call question number 7, Sandish Gohani.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it has undertaken any evaluation of the relative economic benefits of small modular nuclear reactors compared with other forms of energy provision.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, President Officer. The Scottish Government does not support the building of new nuclear fission power stations in Scotland under current technologies. Whilst SMRs are innovative in their size and construction technique, they use the same method of electricity generation as traditional nuclear fission. This means the same environmental concerns as traditional nuclear power plants, while their economic competitive is still to be proven in practice. New nuclear power could take decades to become operational and would be expensive, pushing up household bills. As set out in our draft energy strategy and just transition plan, significant growth in renewables, storage, hydrogen and carbon capture provide the best pathway to net zero and will deliver a climate-friendly energy system that delivers affordable, resilient and clean energy for Scotland.
Sandish Gohani.
Thank you, Minister. France delivers 70% of its electricity from nuclear energy, giving it a great baseload, and is now the world's largest net exporter of electricity. Does the Scottish Government have any estimate of the opportunity cost that of Scotland not pursuing a similar strategy?
Minister.
The fact is that existing nuclear is expensive. Under the current contract awarded by the UK Government to Hinkley Point C, for example, the electricity that will be generated will be priced at £92.50 per megawatt hour. That's comparison to electricity generated from offshore wind, which we have in abundance in Scotland, and our planning to do an awful lot more, which is currently priced at £37.35 per megawatt hour. He mentions France. However, let's look at a list of all the European countries
Minister,
that have decided
your seat
to
for a
ditch
second.
Nuclear.
Please resume your seat for a second. I don't need a running commentary from a sedentary position whilst the Minister is seeking to respond to the question. Minister, please resume.
Okay, so I can list. In April, Germany shut down the last of its three nuclear power plants, joining other member states which have no nuclear power stations and remain opposed to nuclear power, including Austria, Denmark, Ireland, Italy, Estonia, Latvia, Luxembourg, Malta and Portugal.
And I call question number 8, Mercedes Bielba.
To ask the Scottish Government when it will publish its final energy and just transition strategy.
Minister Gillian Martin.
The 23-24 programme for government confirmed our commitment to publish and start implementing a new energy strategy and just transition plan. We are fully considering the views expressed in the consultation that took place earlier this year and will provide further details on this shortly.
Mercedes Bielba.
I thank the Minister for that answer. When the Scottish Government published its draft strategy, the Scottish Trades Union Congress said workers had little faith in the government's plan. In light of the SUC's submission to the government's consultation, can the minister set out precisely what policy changes have been incorporated since then into the final strategy?
Minister.
Well, the final strategy, as I've said, has not been published. However, I would recommend that Mercedes Villalba come to the chamber tomorrow to listen to my statement on the vision for Scotland's future energy, and that will give more information about when the energy strategy will be published. But of course, she will understand that she's asking for detail of a final strategy which is not published yet.
And supplementary, Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As outlined in the draft energy strategy and just transition plan, all the evidence tells us that we can protect and create jobs in Scotland if we ensure that we get our energy transition right. How will the recent Tory net zero U-turns impact on this transition moving forward? And does the Minister agree that the Tory backtracking and the uncertainty caused could harm, hold back the growth in renewable energy jobs and harm our economic future?
Minister.
I thank Kevin Stewart for that question. He will be aware of the recent report from Robert Gordon University, Powering Up the Workforce report, which shows that Scotland has got enormous energy potential and we have the natural resources, the skills required to lead the global energy transition. But Kevin Stewart is right. The UK government's backtracking is putting green jobs, inward investment and economic growth at risk. And I would also highlight the failure to secure any offshore wind projects in the recent allocation round five. We have made representation to the UK government, and I believe the sector has made a great deal of representation to the UK government about improvements we want to see ahead of AR6.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on wellbeing, economy, fair work and energy. And I would now propose to move to the second portfolio questions this afternoon, which is finance and parliamentary business. Again, if a member wishes to request a supplementary, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function if online. And at question number one, I call Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the fiscal framework.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robinson.
I'm pleased to say that the first review of the Scottish Fiscal Framework concluded on the 2nd of August with a joint agreement reached between the Scottish and UK governments on changes to the 2016 agreement. This review has yielded a fair and pragmatic set of changes, providing a sensible and proportionate set of improvements to the fiscal framework. This furnishes the Scottish Government with more effective levers with which to manage the Scottish budget. I welcome the opportunity for a full debate in this chamber in the coming months, in addition to a dedicated committee evidence session.
Liam Kerr.
I'm grateful to Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and just as she's done there, the Cabinet Secretary made clear in her letter to the Finance Committee on the 2nd of August that she was signing up to this new deal because the arrangements work in Scotland's favour, and the changes made, as the Cabinet Secretary just said, are fair and pragmatic and will strengthen the financial management leaves available to the Scottish Government. So does the Cabinet Secretary therefore agree it's exactly this sort of joint working between the Westminster and Holyrood administrations the public both wants and deserves, rather than endless constitutional bickering which so often characterises our politics?
Cabinet Secretary.
What I would say is that John Glenn, who is the Chief Secretary to the Treasury, is actually a bit of an anomaly in the Westminster Tory UK government. He actually does sit down in a sensible, pragmatic, cooperative way, but he's the exception to the rule, actually. And that is why we have managed to secure these very pragmatic changes to the fiscal framework. Because of that arrangement. And again, I had a very cooperative meeting with the Chief Secretary to the Treasury just last week. It is just a shame that the rest of the UK government doesn't operate in that manner.
And supplementary, John Mason.
Thank you. There was some concern under the previous fiscal framework that we are competing with London and the south east of England, and that puts us in a difficult position. Does the Cabinet Secretary have any concerns that that will continue to be the case?
Cabinet Secretary.
So let me say that I'm confident that we are well placed to build our fairer, greener economy. And of course, per person, our economy has outperformed the UK's since 2018. The latest data shows that our income tax performance per capita is improving and outperforming the rest of the UK in 2022-23. But of course it is clear that the UK economic model is disproportionately weighted towards London, and that has an impact on Scotland. And of course, I'm sure as John Mason would agree with me, with the full powers of independence, we'd be able to tailor our economic approach to Scotland's needs and emulate the success of our near European neighbours, who all perform more strongly economically than the UK.
Question number two, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recommendations regarding taxation policy in Oxfam GB's analysis, payment overdue, fair ways to make polluters across the UK pay for climate justice.
Cabinet Secretary.
So as Oxfam's report recognises, the regulation of fossil fuel industries and the majority of tax powers remain reserved to Westminster. We will keep pressing the UK Government to take the urgent action needed, especially after their recent backsliding on net zero ambitions. Here in Scotland, we are committed to using the powers we have to meet our world-leading climate targets. We will continue with our progressive approach to tax and working to ensure that we achieve a just transition, all of which will help meet our climate goals, safeguard jobs and protect those on lowest incomes.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? Transport remains Scotland's most polluting and highest emitting sector, and an investigation by the Scotsman revealed that over 1,500 empty or nearly empty commercial passenger flights, also known as ghost flights, passed through Scottish airports last year. This has to change. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary whether she agrees with the report's recommendations on taxation for reducing air travel demand? And what her view is on implementing a higher tax for more polluting aircraft, such as private jets?
Cabinet Secretary.
So we very much recognise the impact of transport on overall carbon emissions, and we're committed to reducing emissions across all modes of transport, including air travel. We remain committed to introducing the air departure tax once a solution is found to the Highland and Islands exemption has been identified, which of course is not an easy process. In doing so, we'll carry out a review of the rates and bands of the tax to ensure they are aligned with our world-leading climate ambitions.
Question number three, Jamie Halker-Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government what its assessment is of the effectiveness of its current income tax policies in stimulating economic growth and job creation.
Cabinet Secretary.
So we have the most progressive tax system in the UK, which raises additional revenue to invest in public services and Scotland's economy. Since our five-band system was introduced in 2018, our economy has outperformed the UK, with GDP per person, taking into account population growth, growing 0.2% compared to falling 0.8% in the UK, while over 45,000 working-age people have moved from the rest of the UK to Scotland in 2021, with a net in-migration of 5,000 people. And this is consistent with findings from our policy evaluation of the 2018-19 income tax reforms, which shows no evidence they were having a negative impact on the economy.
Jamie Halker-Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Appearing in front of the Finance Committee on the 19th of September, David Bell, Professor of Economics at the University of Stirling, told my colleague Liz Smith that, and I quote, "Where you have differential tax rates between jurisdictions, you will set up incentives that will cause either capital or labour to move. That move might not be instantaneous, but if two distinct tax systems sit close by each other, incentives are created over time." So given that under this SNP Green coalition, Scotland is now the highest tax part of the United Kingdom, can the Cabinet Secretary tell me how the Scottish Government is monitoring for the long term any movements of this nature?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I set out in my first answer, there's no evidence of such movement. Of course, people move to Scotland and stay in Scotland because of a range of factors, not least the social contract and the various policies and supports that are available here that are not available elsewhere. I would also remind the member that based on the figures of the Scottish Fiscal Commission, the Scottish Government calculates that over 52% of taxpayers in Scotland pay less than they would if they lived elsewhere in the UK. So these matters will be kept under review. Obviously, that's why I've set up the expert group on taxation to inform me in terms of current and future tax policy. But what the Tories can't get away from, of course, is that they want tax cuts. But they still come here asking for more public expenditure. There's no system in the world that supports that type of economic model.
I have received requests from a number of members seeking a supplementary. I intend to accede to each request. I call firstly supplementary from Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Deputy First Minister quantify the damage of UK Tory tax policies announced in last September's mini-budget and since on Scotland's economic growth and job creation?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the disastrous mini-budget is indicative of the ongoing economic mismanagement of the Tory government, which has given us the highest inflation in the G7. This is causing real hardship to families in Scotland, with the UK's high inflation part of the reason that the Office for Budget Responsibility is forecasting the largest fall in living standards on record, with real incomes falling by £1,200 by the end of this year.
I call supplementary from Michael Mara.
Thank you, President Officer. Speaking to the Finance Committee last week, Professor David Heald warned that we will get into a position whereby National Health Service consultants will start negotiating with their employers for net pay, and stressed the need to be very careful. So when we need to attract key talent, for example, breast cancer oncologists in Dundee, can I ask the Deputy First Minister, what assessment has the Scottish Government made of the impact of income tax policies on the recruitment challenges in our NHS workforce?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's hard to work out who's Labour and who's the Tories these days in this chamber. Let me say two things to Michael Mara. NHS consultants in Scotland are not on strike as they are down south. Let me say another thing. NHS consultants get paid more. Junior doctors get paid more here in Scotland than they do down south. So when doctors come here to Scotland, they will take into a range of factors into account, and not least the paying conditions that they get, as well as all the services that they get and the additional elements of the social contract that I explained earlier on. But what a strange line of questioning for a Labour member in this chamber.
Supplementary, Willie Rennie.
When John Swinney was the long-standing, wise and cautious Finance Secretary, he knew about the balance, the careful balance to avoid behavioural change. The Finance Secretary or Deputy First Minister seems very bullish about the tax rises. I thought the last set of tax rises were an emergency rise, but now the government's talking about further rises. Is she sure she's getting the balance right?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, let me say really clearly to Willie Rennie, no decisions have been made around taxation in any form until we get into the budget process. What I was describing was a set of tax decisions that have already been taken that leads Scotland to be the most progressive part of the United Kingdom by having those five tax bands, which takes account of what people actually earn in terms of the tax that they pay. So in terms of going forward, we will of course take very careful consideration of all of the issues that we should do in coming to the conclusions about what is the right balance between tax, the funding of public services, and making sure that we are able to sustain those public services. Because while Labour come to this chamber wanting us to not make any additional revenues on taxation or anything else, it seems, that does then pose the question of where the money comes from to pay for the public services and the demands that members across
this
chamber
make on a regular
basis. Thank you, Cabinet
Secretary. The next question, which will be supplementary from John Swinney.
Also, from my careful and long-serving perspective, does the Deputy First Minister agree with me that it is somewhat rich for Jamie Halkrow-Johnson as a Scottish Conservative to come here and complain about differential taxation when his colleagues supported the concept of this Parliament having the ability to vary those tax powers and responsibilities in accordance with the needs of people in Scotland? And does she agree with me that the judgments individuals will form in the careful behavioural analysis that's undertaken in all these questions will take into account all of the benefits of living in Scotland in terms of the availability of public services, lower council tax, access to a range of free services, and to have the ability to send their children...
We will now turn to the Cabinet Secretary's response. Cabinet Secretary.
I agree with every word of that, and the important thing is looking at the evidence. And the evidence in the round, as John Swinney absolutely correctly pointed out, that people in Scotland get a range of services not available anywhere else in these islands. And actually, those on lower incomes are supported in a way they're not supported anywhere else in these islands, and that according to the Scottish Fiscal Commission, 52% of taxpayers in Scotland still pay less than they would elsewhere in these islands. So we have to look at these things in the round, and we have to take careful consideration. But what we will not do is to follow the economic catastrophe and the policies that led to that, which seem to be being replicated and articulated in this chamber. We will certainly not do that, because we know the damage it does to households and to businesses.
Thank you. I now call question number 4, Cole Cap-Stewart. Monsieur, I think you've got a problem with your card. If you take your card out and put it in again, perhaps that might work. Okay. Could we have Ms Stewart's microphone? Or perhaps Ms Stewart indeed could seek to try again. Perfect. Ms Stewart.
To ask the Scottish Government, in light of the ongoing local governance review, what discussions the Minister for Community, Wealth and Public Finance has had with ministerial colleagues regarding any potential benefits to public services and assets granting Glasgow metropolitan status.
Minister Tom Arthur.
The local governance review is a key element of the Verity House Agreement and an important opportunity to strengthen local decision making. We are equally committed to delivering regional economic development and will continue to work with regional partnerships as we take forward the recommendations stemming from the Regional Economic Policy Review. We will also continue to work with the Glasgow City Region on their ambitions, and I will engage with ministerial colleagues on how work in this space can be expanded to further empower all of Scotland's regions.
Cook-up Stewart.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Metropolitan status is given to city regions in other parts of the UK and in many European nations. And like Glasgow, many of these cities are home to nationally significant infrastructures, such as the Clyde Tunnel, for instance, where Glasgow City Council is investing £3 million over the next 2 years, and the upkeep of Glasgow Botanic Gardens, while the Botanic Gardens in Edinburgh are directly funded by the Scottish Government. Does the Minister share my view that there is room for a healthy discussion on the long-term funding settlement regarding national assets in Scotland's largest city?
Minister.
There is no doubt that the Glasgow City Region is a key engine of the Scottish economy. Capitalising on progress made by the Glasgow City Region, we will continue to work in partnership with Glasgow City Council and the other local authorities in the region. We support the region in attracting inward investment to support the regional economic strategy, which will help to create a sustainable wellbeing economy and tackle inequality. The published Regional Economic Policy Review contains a recommendation to explore the aggregation of budgets to increase capacity within regions. Officials are scoping out options for delivery. In regards to the Clyde Tunnel, it is on the local road network, and all local authorities are responsible for their own road networks. The Royal Botanic Gardens Edinburgh operates a total of 4 gardens and has a statutory responsibility to safeguard Scotland's National Living Plant Collection and Herbarium. It also has a global presence and status in the world of plant-based scientific research and education, and so is a very different model from the Glasgow Botanics.
And a supplementary from Pam Gozo.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, local authorities across the country are facing a combined 2-year shortfall of £1 billion. Much of the remainder will be dedicated to immediate needs, essential statutory services and workforce shortages. Does the Scottish Government believe granting metropolitan status to Glasgow City Region offers a solution for service and infrastructure challenges?
Minister.
Well, I thank Ms Gosso for a supplementary question. We have no plans to pursue a mayoral or metropolitan model in the style of what's been taking place elsewhere in the UK. But in many respects, Glasgow Region is already functioning as a metropolitan area. So we are committed to working in partnership with all of the local partners, the local authorities and the communities to ensure that we can capitalise upon Glasgow's status and look for opportunities through partnership working to generate efficiencies and better, more person-centred delivery of public services.
I call question number 5, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government how the measures set out in its programme for government 2023-24 will support community wealth building.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Employment of the community wealth building model of economic development has the potential to improve the impact of a wide range of measures set out in the new programme for government. Specifically, in the year ahead, we will work to ensure procurement activity continues to contribute to community wealth building in the form of stronger businesses and high-quality jobs. The programme for government also confirms that we will collaborate with our partners in the public, private, third and community sectors on legislative proposals informed by the recent community wealth building public consultation.
Colin Beattie.
The community wealth building approach is clearly one of our most effective tools if we are to build a sustainable wellbeing economy where everybody in Scotland can thrive. Would the Minister agree that measures this year to support our local economies and supply chains will help lay the groundwork for a comprehensive community wealth building bill later in the parliamentary term?
Minister.
I do. I agree that the community wealth-building approach is one of the most effective tools we have to create a sustainable wellbeing economy, supporting business growth and the creation of fair jobs. We will continue to build on the excellent progress that has been made to date by local authorities, working in partnership with communities, businesses, the third sector and wider public sector organisations to support the implementation of the approach. We will publish the findings of the recent consultation on community wealth building legislation later in the autumn. The consultation provided a rich source of ideas and evidence that will help frame the development of legislative proposals to advance community wealth building in Scotland.
I call question number 6, Douglas Lumsden.
To ask the Scottish Government whether the Finance Secretary plans to allocate to local authorities any funding from the block grant that has arisen as a result of Barnett Consequential Funding from the UK Government's Swimming Pool Support Fund.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you. Local sport and leisure facilities, including swimming pools, are vital in supporting the physical and mental health of the nation. Compared to the less than £6 million of consequentials the Scottish Government received for swimming pools following the UK Government's budget, Scottish Government allocated £100 million of additional funding to local government at stage 3 of the budget bill, funded in part by those consequentials.
Dr. Sampson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think it's immoral of this government to get funding for swimming pools from the UK Treasury but not pass it on for its intended purpose. In Aberdeen, Buxburn swimming
members,
pool...
Members, we need to hear Mr. Lumsden. Mr. Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In Aberdeen, Buxburn swimming pool was closed and has been stripped back to the walls by the local SNP council and being taken to court by their own citizens over the closure. Is the Minister happy that swimming pools in our communities are being forced to close?
Minister.
The Member knows, I know because he was a local councillor, that councillors are democratically elected to make decisions on the priorities in their local communities. It's really important that as elected members we respect the democratic mandate of councillors across Scotland. But I think the difference here, the money has all been allocated. The difference here is clearly that Mr. Lumsden is coming to this chamber asking the Scottish...
Minister, please resume your seat for a second. There are members shouting across all parts of the chamber. That is not acceptable. The Minister has been asked a question. We must listen to the Minister's response. Minister.
Presiding Officer, as I've said, the money has been allocated. The money was allocated to budgets as part of a £100 million additional funding at stage 3 that went to local government. What Mr. Lumsden is coming here asking is that that money should have been ring-fenced. Now, I encourage Mr. Lumsden to speak to his local government colleagues because I know that his local government colleagues are looking for greater flexibility. They are not asking us to come and ring-fence more and more pots of money. In fact, they're asking exactly the opposite, for greater flexibility so they can use their democratic mandates to determine what is best for their local communities.
And I call it question number 7, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to propose a parliamentary debate on the removal of nuclear weapons from Scotland as proposed in its paper, Creating a Modern Constitution for an Independent Scotland.
Minister George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As Mr Kidd knows, any proposal for government business in Parliament are agreed by the Scottish Cabinet, subject to consideration by the Parliamentary Bureau and in turn approval by Parliament. The Scottish Government's fourth paper in Building a New Scotland series, Creating a Modern Constitution for an Independent Scotland, was published on the 19th of June. The Cabinet Secretary then led a debate on the paper on the 27th of June.
Bill Kidd.
Thank the Minister for that. I know time is precious and I may lodge a member's motion on the issue, which I hope those across the chamber will support. For when war is raging on Europe's borders and the spectre of nuclear escalation is ever present, does the Minister agree with me that it is not only time to have this debate here, but across Europe, to start the journey to a nuclear weapons-free Europe, as has happened in areas across the globe, and would he be happy to support Scotland taking a lead in this journey?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mr Kidd has been at the front of this debate for many years, and I do, of course, agree that a nuclear-free world would be most welcome. It is, of course, entirely up to the member if he wishes to lodge a member's motion. Our Parliament is made all the richer with the varied debate and discussion we have in members' debates and what they bring to this place.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on finance and parliamentary business. And there will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change positions should they wish. Thank you.